It is a pleasure to welcome Roberto Antonelli to the University of Rochester and to this celebration of our Italian Baroque organ. He speaks to us this afternoon on the topic of Italian influences in the music of the Jesuit reductions. Please welcome Roberto Antonello.
Good afternoon. The Jesuit reductions in South America developed between 1609 and 1768 along the immense territories where nowadays Argentina, Brazil, Uruguay, Paraguay, and Bolivia exist. During that 1.5 century, an incredible activity related also to the arts developed through the inputs coming from Europe and the works of the Jesuit missionaries. The music were considered an educational tool, attracting the natives to the villages and making them more malleable to accept the new rules imposed by the social life in the reductions. The name of Domenico Zipoli is the main Italian name connected with music in the reductions. Due to the fact that a huge amount of music circulating in the villages was by unknown composers, and knowing the fact that many artists of various fields moved there from different European countries to South America, I wonder. Who were the most active musicians in the reduction? Second question, what Italian artists in a wider sense moved there? What were the Italian musicians active there? And what was the Italian influence in the music? And was there any legacy? That is also important to see if there was a legacy in it. So the first question is, who were the most active musicians in the reductions? Through the chronicles of the times and the reports of emissaries coming from Europe, we discover a number of musicians who were active during those 150 years. Rodrigo de Melgarejo from Spain, Jean Vesseau from Belgium, Louis Berger from France, Anton Sepp from Caldaro. At the time it was in South Tyrol, Austria, but nowadays is Italy. Domenico Zipoli from Prato and Marty Schmidt from Switzerland. The extraordinary music result the Jesuits achieved in the reductions arrived to Europe during the 18th century, and Pope Benedict XIV wrote about this in his encyclical dated 19 February 1749. He wrote, "The use of harmonic or figurative chant has spread all over the world, and even in the missions in Paraguay it is realized, because those believers in America have an innate gift both for vocal and instrumental music. They have been so successful, the missionaries, to teach music that nowadays almost no difference exists between the masses and vespers sung in our churches in Europe and those performed in the reductions." So it's a witness of the high level that was reached at the time. Just to have an idea of what was the life in the missions, in the heart of South America, the Jesuits were able to found over 30 villages, mixing civic and religious life. Some priests in each village led the social organization with the help of the native Indians, gathering a total of 150,000 inhabitants, including churches, building churches and houses, cultivating the fields, and breeding domestic animals like cows, chickens, hens, rabbits, donkeys, up to 250,000 heads of cattle. So it was really a huge work that was done at the time. They introduced also a sort of a welfare system protecting widows and orphans, and granting the necessary for everyday life to the weakest part of the society. In this sort of Catholic communist society, education had a central role. Compared with the Dominicans using Spanish language or Franciscans at a later time that were adopting local languages like the Chiquita and the Guarani, the Jesuits stressed the importance of using the Latin in sacred music while approaching the natives through their own languages who were learned beforehand. The use of the Latin language meant not only the use of the universal language of the Roman Church, but also teaching a language opening the world of knowledge since all the main books were written in Latin, providing the natives with a chance to approach European culture and, as a consequence of it, to create a condition for a democratic evolution of the society. Music itself was a tool of civilization. Many people were able to play musical instruments. We have a lot of description of it. The inventory is done at the Jesuits' expulsion in 1768 under the kingdom that Spanish King Charles III described a lot of European instruments formerly imported from Europe and later locally built according to the models or with tiny changes. So, for example, violins, a remark is to the body of the instrument that is larger in this point. It has particular resonance in the low tones. Or cellos, a double bass and tromba marina. Tromba marina is a sort of a monochord that is played as a string instrument. I don't know the English for it. It's in Italian, it's called in this way. Flutes, trumpets, like here, bassoons, dulcians, harps, harpsichord, and organs, as well as many scores belonging to the missions. About two-thirds of the villages had two organs, the main one being installed in the church, the second one being a positive to be played in processions. Very few instruments survived the expulsions. Spanish and Portuguese army destroyed and sacked the villages. And so it's these were part of the instruments that were found and moved to the museum. So the second question is, what Italian artists in a wider sense moved there? So many Italians moved from their birthplace to South America for different reasons. The utopia of a social of a society without evil or an earth paradise attracted many people, not only Jesuit priests. I will not show a complete list of names since, in fact, the movement from Italy to South America was rather the first big emigration than an individual trip. Yet some artists and their activities are connected with music. I am mainly referring to the architects, since their buildings were conditioning the performance music as it was in Europe. And the relation between music and the place, a space where it is or it was performed, is very strict. Among the founders of the reduction, we mention Giuseppe Cataldini. It was a Jesuit born in Fabriano near Ancona, active in Sant'Ignazio Mini, and Simone Maceta, born in Castiglenti and active in Nostra Signora de Loreto. It seems that they also introduced some musical instruments in the missions, being the originators of the reductions. Later on, many missionaries were experiencing different arts, mainly architecture. So we mention Giuseppe Bresanelli, who built he was a Lombard architect and painter, great admirer of Bernini, who built St. Peter's in Rome and the Trevi Fountain. Bresanelli built the main church in Sant'Ignazio Mini with Angelo Camillo Petragrassa, born in Pavia. He came as parish priest in 1691. The church was finished in 1724 and has a size of 70 per 28 meters. So it was really a huge church. Bresanelli was also named the second Michelangelo and brought the Roman art in the reductions. He was buried inside this church. Giovanni Andrea Bianchi, born in Campione d'Italia near Como, was an architect who worked with Bresanelli and Petragrassa, being active in Cordoba and in the Estancia di Santa Catalina, where it is buried Domenico Zipoli. Giovanni Battista Primoli was born in Milano and was inspired by the Roman Baroque art. He was active in Buenos Aires, Cordoba, St. Michael and Trinity. These are the names of the villages. In 1720, he went to Cordoba, taking part in the building of the Collegio Massimo and the University, as well as lifting the final construction of the majestic Baroque Cathedral. Andrea Bianchi was charged to finish it. Other works of his were the churches of the villages of San Miguel, Trinidad, and Concepcion in the Guayran missions. Pier Paolo Danesi from Baluco was an architect and expert in mechanical clocks construction. Other noteworthy figures are Agostino Salumbrini, who went there beginning of the 17th century. He was a male nurse, and in 1630, for the first time, he used the quinine to treat the malaria. Padre Bonaventura Suarez was the first astronomer in the missions. In spite of the distance, he worked in cooperation with the other astronomers in Vienna and in St. Petersburg, leading important studies on the lunar movements. He fused the first bronze bell in the redaction and is remembered as the inventor of chocolate with peanuts. Antonio Mazzoni, born in Iglesias in Sardinia, he was a linguist and then became rector of the Collegio Massimo in Cordoba and procurator in Roma of the provinces of Paraguay. So, as you see, art, study, and research played an important role in those communities. What were the Italian musicians active there, and what was the Italian influence in the music? So we have a direct influence of the Italians and indirect. Direct influences in music are due to the musicians who moved to South America. In fact, any musician or composer was bringing not only his own instrument or music, but also his musical background, made of several aspects, as well as of the teachings received in youth or the contacts with the contemporaries. There are at least two outstanding names among the ones I mentioned at the beginning, Anto Seppand and Domenico Zipoli. But before their arrival, we must mention Pietro Commentale, who was born in Naples, and this is very important. He taught music in Cordoba and Buenos Aires in the missions of Yapeyú and San Ignacio Mini from 1610 to 1640. He introduced the music in Rio de la Plata, and he was asked in 1628 to present an ensemble of Indian musicians in the harbor of Buenos Aires to welcome a contingent of European missionaries. Anto Sepp was born in Caldaro, not far from Bolzano, so nowadays it is in Italy. He studied in Innsbruck and in Vienna, and he was a singer in the court choir. It is written that he was able to play up to 20 different instruments. And this is very important because his name is connected with the import of any sort of European instrument in South America, as well for teaching. We have witnesses that he was able to train at least 20 to 30 musicians per year in different instruments. So it means that in 1 year, more or less, one, maximum 2 years, he was able to teach how to play violin, how to play harpsichord or organ or trumpet or flute. So it's incredible from this point of view. He's also considered to be the builder of the first organ with the pedal board produced in the redactions and to be delivered in the Yapeyú missions. We have here some pictures, some details of the organ that I collected. For sure, he imported in South America all kinds of instruments, and he was considered also a pioneer in iron fusion and in cotton manufacture, that is till nowadays the most exported product of Paraguay. He also, his name is also related to the Paraguayan harp. So the mission of Saint John the Baptist was well known for the musical instruments. They were built and they were delivered through emissaries to other villages, since every village had orchestras and choirs where the Indians played and sang. Music scores were sent in the same way all over South America, departing mainly from Cordoba, now Argentina, that was the main city after sailing the Atlantic Ocean to Buenos Aires. Zipoli music has the same chance. Domenico Zipoli was born in Prato, near Florence. He studied, as I said this morning, in Prato, then in Florence, then moved to Naples to study with Alessandro Scarlatti, then with with Felice Lavinio Vannucci in Bologna, and finally Finally, he, with the help of Cosimo III, he studied in Roma with Bernardo Pasquini in 1710. From 10 to 14, he presented in Rome the Vespri and Mass for the Feast of St. Charles in San Carlo ai Catinari Church. So, Vespers and Mass. There is another link with the concert of tonight. The Oratory Sant'Antonio di Padova e Santa Maria della Vallicella, and another oratorio, Santa Caterina Vergine e Martire in the Church of San Girolamo della Carità. In 1715 he was organist in Chiesa del Gesù in Roma, and in 1716 he published Sonate di Intavolatura per organo e cimbalo, issued in Roma and then in London. The contact with Pasquini was very important for Zipoli. Large use of ornaments, irregular melodic patterns, chromatism, and a certain freedom in rhythm were retained. Almost all Zipoli's pieces had lost. We remember his cantata, Delle offese a vendicarmi, for soprano and continuo, now in Berlin Deutsche Bibliothek, and a sonata for violin and continuo in Dresden Landesbibliothek, both date probably on 1717. In 1716 he entered into the Jesuit order, went to Sevilla through Genova, and then moved to Rio de la Plata. In those years, the historian Pedro Lozano, who later left many references to Zipoli's life, and the architects Primoli and Bianchi traveled more or less together in the same direction. And even if only set in Cordoba for his weak health, Zipoli was very popular at the time. You see, it is quoted in this ordinarium. You see, Veatus Vir is a modification of the Spanish pronunciation by Zipoli. So it was very important if it was mentioned in this ordinarium for the Mass. Many manuscripts were discovered, and in particular, the American musicologist Robert Stevenson in 1958 amazed the music world by discovering in the archives of Sucre in Bolivia a manuscript of a Mass with the title Mass by Zipoli for four voices copied in Potosi in 1784. So it was already copied in 1784. Many other pieces like Beatus Vir and Confitebor are mentioned in the inventories at the expulsion of the Jesuits. Other scores appeared in mosses brought by the Indians themselves who preserved them for years. How you can easily imagine, these copies are full of mistakes in the text and in music as well. But through them, this repertory, otherwise lost forever, has been saved. The archive in Concepcion, in Sant' Ignazio de Mossos, and the guardian musician in Santa Ana reduction passed us this world heritage, disappearing at the end of the 90s. Most of the scores give clear reference to the performance concerning instruments, continuo parts of free voices, choir with solos, tempo, dynamics, and articulation. Zipoli's music is performed till nowadays in the main ceremonies, leaving apart all problems connected with the attribution of this music, we can remark the following peculiar features. The general absence of the bass voice. It is said that the Indians were not able to play, to sing in the bass voice. And the pieces with the bass voices were composed when somebody arrived from Europe. Alternating of solos and choral parts. General indication of strings, violins contrasting with a large number of instruments listed in inventories, suggesting the possibility to arrange the parts more freely. Both complete and separate parts are present and may be found. Generally, dynamic is indicated in the separate parts. The continuo is sometimes written with a few and simple chords. Second violin sometimes overtaking the first one, then jumping one octave lower in the alto region. The music can be played with strings mainly in first position, so they can easy to be learned. And the music underwent a process similar to Handel's music, being reused in several pieces in excerpts. Zipoli's masses have neither Benedictus nor Agnus Dei, generally, reminding us some Missa Brevis composed in Europe. We have the example of a Missa Sant' Ignazio that is complete, but some other Misses are incomplete with only Kyrie and Gloria. Female voices were performed by children, and they achieved the result is a high solemn atmosphere with a very simple means. As far as concerns the organ method, Principia Servo d'Elementa Bene Pulsandum Organum et Cimbalum, I already mentioned it was on the way, perhaps already in Rome. We have these witnesses that he was working on it. He moved in South America, and then finally he prepared a collection of pieces that we found with this same title. A copy of this book has been brought from Cordoba, now Argentina, to Chiquitos in Bolivia, by Father Esteban Palozzi, who also traveled with Zipoli. These pieces are indistinctly for organ or harpsichord. There are also included some pieces by Juan Messner and Marty Schmidt, who copied this collection of pieces in a later time and added some more pieces of them. Among the minor Italian musicians, we mention also Gaetano Cattaneo, arriving from Modena in 1729 and died in 1733. Besides this, we have an indirect influence of many Italians. We have a strong influence of the Neapolitan composers like Scarlatti, Durante, Feo, and Pergolesi, who reached the South America through their influence in Roma and through Spain. So it was a double way to reach South America, as well as Corelli, that was adapted to be played on a keyboard instrument by Zipoli himself. You find here inside several excerpts from Opus 5 by Corelli. It's an opus for violin and continuo. So a final question, was there any legacy about it? We wonder what kind of a legacy was handed over after the direct presence of the Italian composers, as well as the indirect influence we just mentioned. Were the Italian Jesuits able to create a school allowing autonomous development? From chronicles of the time, we know that the School of Music in Santa Rosa Missions became famous thanks to the works of Antonio Guayaquil, who was a pupil of Zipoli. So Zipoli was able to develop a local school. Julian Attirau, in 18th century, studied in a Jesuit reduction, and he is known because he wrote a rondo and minuet for violin, for two violins, printed in the missions. In fact, this is Arenberg's canon, and you will see. It was this piece was considered highly ingenious at that time, because two players, one in front of the other, performed the piece, and when they arrived at the end, they turn the score and can play the same melody in a reverse order, and the music is affecting all the same. So it's really ingenious. And later on, we have the name of Cristobal Piriobi, who was born in 1765 and died at age of 30, who went to Buenos Aires, who was an Indian, went to Buenos Aires and was considered a great expert in Italian music, in particular on Boccherini and Clementi. He was a harpsichordist, well known, but he taught also singing, violin, to play violin and guitar. He was also able to build several instruments. And so we see that in his library, we found those scores by Haydn, Boccherini, Clementi, Stamets, Pleyel. So with a lot of a variety in instrumentation, demonstrating a high musical knowledge. He died in Buenos Aires, and the inventories we find two keyboard instruments with a cedar wood, one finished and the other almost finished, one with a hammer and the other with plectrums. The one strung spinet always in cedar wood, three guitar just finished. So he was able to create a variety of instruments. If you had the chance to reach those lands and to meet people in the villages, the Jesuit music, joined with the Italian influence, is still present today. Some pieces are still sung and or played by the natives after almost three centuries, in particular some of Zipoli's vocal pieces. The legacy has become a cultural heritage, something unifying those people and belonging to their collective past, a cultural identity to be preserved and to make a living on. Thank you.
To know if, when the Jesuits came to South America, whether they brought chant books with them for the mass and for the offices, and whether that would have been the Medicean edition from the early 17th century. What do we have any records of them bringing the kind of chant books that would have been needed?
For the Jesuits, culture was a very important aspect, So they tried to move the best that was in Europe to create this sort of a real utopia, if we may say this, oxymoron. It's because they tried to build a state without evil. So the best of the European culture was moved there. The best of the technology, we have, for example, even before the Jesuits, the printing in South America was very important. The first book was printed in the missions and then was brought to Buenos Aires. They installed a printing house in the in 1582 in a mission. So it was something very important. And for the Jesuit, the culture to access knowledge was a really powerful means for everybody. I think it's something that they must really be stressed, because the main books of the time were written in Latin. If you were able to understand Latin language, you have access to the whole knowledge of the time. If you don't know Latin, you cannot access it. And Latin came in use through a large use in the liturgy, of course. And then it was taught in the school, so it was a tool as it was a music, for example. And so they tried to bring the best, trying also to adapt to the local systems. But it was something really astonishing because it involved several aspects of a civil life.
So you mentioned the copy of the Zippy Mass from 1784, I think. So I was wondering, can you say any more about patterns of transmission for Zippy's music, for the choral music or the organ music, and whether this was really staying very locally within a particular community or passing around with different mission communities?
Yeah, this is very interesting because Zipoli moved to South America. He arrived first in Buenos Aires, then moved to Cordoba. And it was everywhere written that he died in Cordoba. In reality, he was not dying in Cordoba, but in the Estancia of Santa Catalina, that is near Cordoba. He never moved from there because he has a weak health and he was not able to travel from one mission to the other. And so his music was copied several times at this time, and through emissaries was reaching different villages and spread all over the villages. Otherwise, there would no reason to mention Beatus Vir by Zipoli in Ordo Missae, or to quote in the inventories at the expulsion of the Jesuit to say, oh, we have this and this and this instrument, we have this and this and this statue, we have this and this and this painting, as we have this and this and this pieces by Zipoli. So Zipoli was always mentioned. He was so famous that maybe also somebody else added Zipoli's name to scores that are not by Zipoli. And the problem is that when there was the expulsion of the Jesuits, there were also the destruction of these communities, so that the natives tried to save what was possible to save at the time. If you saw the film, the movie The Mission by Robert Joffé with Robert De Niro as main actor, you can have an idea what happened at the time. Of course, it is a movie, but the historical background is true. So there was a lot of destruction, and the natives tried really to save what they could. The Jesuits moved something from the missions to other places, like in Cordoba or like in the main cities, in Chiquito or so on. So part was saved in that way. Part remained hidden in the between the ruins. The architect Hans Roth in the 80s was charged by the UNESCO to class the monuments there. And he reached a mission and he found a wooden box. And when he opened it, he found a lot of scores classified as TP. It's a toilet paper. It was a box full of scores. So many music was lost forever. And another part of the repertory was saved through these guardian angels that were some Indians that were able to collect everything in very fast time and to bring it in the forest so that it could not be reached by the Spanish and the Portuguese. And they saved in this way ornaments, furniture of the churches, sculptures, instruments, music also. And you know, it's impossible to keep a music so long in a forest with such a huge humidity. And so for this reason, it was copied several times. Pieces were added and modified. There are a lot of mistakes. Some of music are now spread and they are not collected all together. So there are different problems also of attribution in this sense.
We have time for one more question. My question is more related to Zeeboli's personal trajectory. I was reading Stevenson the other day, and he mentions that during the early Bourbon period, Madrid had become essentially an Italian fiefdom, that the music of Italian composers and performers had become the rage in the court. And it would seem to me that Zeeboli could have made quite a name for himself and riches for himself by simply making that trip from Italy to Spain and remaining there as a very successful musician-composer. What do we know anything about his life that would lead us to understand his motivation to leave all that for life in the reductions of these Guarani territories?
Yes, in the reduction they tried always to build these communities, these villages out of the main center because there's a utopical society without evil should have no contact with the main courts and with the main cities. So there is a distinction from the court music and the music in the villages. In the villages, since there was no evil, all the music could in a certain sense be sacred, not only during the rite, but in everyday life, it was assessed by a larger part of the people. We have witnesses that we have a choir and orchestras in every villages with ranging up to 30 to 40 musicians in each villages. We cannot forget that at the time, through Spain, as I said, but also through Portugal, the Portuguese court, the Portuguese king was looking to Italy as the top. You must remember that in 1717, so in the same year Zeeboli went to South America, the king of Portugal started to build the Palacio Nacional de Mafra. It's the huge palace with an enormous library, and it is everything is built in Italian style. So also the king of Portugal has a reference in Rome to the Italian marble, Italian sculptures. And so in the court, the music arrived from Italy through that way, not through Zeeboli. Zeeboli was mainly involved in South America in the range of the second music.
There's another
question, please. His two oratorios, San Antonio di Padua and Santa Caterina,
Is there anything musical left from them, or we just have fragments, or nothing is left, just the titles of the oratorios? Is there any actual music left?
We have witnesses that they were performed, but we don't have the music. So a lot of music of Zipoli is lost, except those two pieces, L'offesa vendicarmi is a cantata that is in Dresden, and the other piece is a sonata for violin and continuo. And of course the sonata di intavolatura, we have the manuscript in Rome, and we found recently another manuscript in Macerata that contains the same pieces plus 9 that were not included in the printed version and are now separately printed by Armelin. They add nothing to the works of Zipoli, but it's important to know that there are also these 9 more pieces for keyboard instruments.
Well, let's thank Roberto for his very informative papers.
If there was a legacy in it. So the first question is, who were the most active musicians in the reductions? Through the chronicles of the times and the reports of emissaries coming from Europe, we discover a number of musicians who were active during those 150 years. Rodrigo de Melgarejo from Spain, Jean Besseau from Belgium, Louis Berger from France, Anton Sepp from Caldaro. At the time it was in South Tyrol, Austria, but nowadays it's Italy. Domenico Zipoli from Prato and Marty Schmidt from Switzerland. The extraordinary music result the Jesuits achieved in the reductions arrived to Europe during the 18th century, and Pope Benedict XIV wrote about this in his encyclical dated 19 February 1749. He wrote, "The use of harmonic or figurative chant has spread all over the world, and even in the missions in Paraguay it is realized, because those believers in America have an innate gift both for vocal and instrumental music. They have been so successful, the missionaries, to teach music, that nowadays almost no difference exists between the masses and vespers sung in our
It is a pleasure to welcome Roberto Antonelli to the University of Rochester and to this celebration of our Italian Baroque organ. He speaks to us this afternoon on the topic of Italian influences in the music of the Jesuit reductions. Please welcome Roberto Antonello.
Good afternoon. The Jesuit reductions in South America developed between 1609 and 1768 along the immense territories where nowadays Argentina, Brazil, Uruguay, Paraguay, and Bolivia exist. During that 1.5 century, an incredible activity related also to the arts developed through the inputs coming from Europe and the works of the Jesuit missionaries. The music were considered an educational tool, attracting the natives to the villages and making them more malleable to accept the new rules imposed by the social life in the reductions. The name of Domenico Zipoli is the main Italian name connected with music in the reductions. Due to the fact that a huge amount of music circulating in the villages was by unknown composers, and knowing the fact that many artists of various fields moved there from different European countries to South America, I wonder. Who were the most active musicians in the reduction? Second question, what Italian artists in a wider sense moved there? What were the Italian musicians active there? And what was the Italian influence in the music? And was there any legacy that is also important to see?